What do we think we mean by the size of a program or the skill of a programmer? Not how do we measure it, but what are we really trying to measure? If we don't understand what attribute we're trying to measure, how can we know if our measure of it is any good? In software engineering, most of our measurements are surrogate measures. What's a surrogate measure? Well, suppose you don't understand how to measure an attribute. Often that's because you don't have a clear idea of what the attribute is. But you think that something you can count easily is probably correlated with that attribute. You don't have a strong model of causation to relate this something that you're counting to the attribute, and you don't know how strong the correlation is between your something and the attribute. If you use that something as your measure of the attribute, that's a surrogate. We use bug counts as surrogates for all sorts of things. How good a tester is, how good a programmer is, how close the program is to being finished, how good the program is, how expensive technical support is going to be, so on. Surrogate measures often lead to predictable problems. For example, when companies measure productivity of testers by counting their bug reports, testers are going to spend lots of time reporting lots of bugs. That's what they're being measured to do. But they won't spend much time on activities that don't directly increase their bug counts. This can have a huge negative impact on collaboration within the test group and on the quality of the work done by the testers. Years ago, I led the testing of a project with enormous variation in bug counts per tester. Some testers reported over 100 bugs a month. One tester averaged 4 bugs a month. The one with 4 bugs a month designed tests that simulated real-life use of the program by experienced users. It took him a lot of time to figure out the details of something that experienced customers would try to achieve, and then to create all the necessary test data to make a test that was representative of the complexity of experienced users' work. So he'd run the first test, and then he'd keep varying his test conditions until either the system failed or he was satisfied that he wasn't going to find a problem. Most weeks, he got his problem, either test data corruption or a crash. No one else on my staff could test anywhere near as well for these kinds of problems, and these were very important problems. I've seen a lot of variations of bug counting to measure tester productivity. For example, some people weight bugs so that a more serious bug or a bug that has a bigger impact gets more weight. But none that I've seen would have changed the weightings in my group enough to recognize this tester's actual impact on our projects. If we had measured tester value with bug counts, he would eventually have changed his testing to improve his statistics. And as a result, my staff would never have found several of the most important bugs that we reported. Bugs that were either found by this tester or found by testers who were coached or inspired by him. How do you replace that? It's normal human behavior to change how you work when you know how you're being measured. That's how we manage people with measurement. We expect people to change what they do to improve their measured results. We reward them for measured improvements, and we punish them for lack of improvement in the numbers. In turn, they're going to do less and less well for things we don't measure them on. This creates serious risks. If we measure poorly, we can drive people to change their behaviors in ways that improve their numbers but harm the project. Those risks are very pronounced with surrogate measures. When we try to measure an attribute that we don't understand, or when we use measures that we don't evaluate for construct validity, our measures are surrogate measures. So here's another example with my favorite bad but common surrogate, bug counts. People use bug find rates to estimate the status of the project. The idea is that if you're not finding bugs, maybe the program's run out of bugs, in which case testing is complete. So we can ask a status question. Are we close to the point at which we won't find more bugs, or are we still far away from it? It's common for companies to create status reporting curves that show how many bugs have been found per week, or how many bugs are still open each week, or other weekly bug statistics. James Bach and I have both created curves like these, so have plenty of our colleagues. We'd use them again. They lead us to ask interesting questions, and they help us explain our thinking to other people on the project. But it's important to recognize that the curves don't actually tell you the state of the product. They only tell you what's being found by the test group. Some people apply a theoretical reliability model to bug curves. On the basis of that model, they predict a week-to-week rate of bug finding and the ultimate ship date of the software. Software projects often finish surprisingly late, so executives and project managers are thrilled with the idea of using relatively early project data and a model to predict the eventual release date of the product. The Weibull model is an example of the reliability models. The Weibull is the name of a famous probability distribution. Some other distributions you've probably heard of are the normal distribution and the exponential distribution. A model relies on a set of assumptions. If the assumptions are incorrect, the model is inapplicable. Eric Simmons from Intel is one of the advocates of the Weibull model. He listed its key assumptions in one of his conference talks. The problem is that these assumptions don't apply well to testing. There are problems with all of them. Let's take a look at three examples. First, the model assumes that testing occurs in a way similar to the way the software will be operated. That's not true. Skilled testers will push the program much harder than normal users to boost their chances of finding bugs. Second, the model assumes that bugs are equally likely to be encountered. That's not true. Some bugs show up almost every time you test the program. Others show up rarely, and they take weeks to reproduce. Third, the model assumes that defects are corrected instantaneously without introducing additional defects. Come on! What's this model smoking? So why does this model seem to fit the data? The Weibull curve has a very flexible shape. If you have a set of data, any set of data, and that data has one peak and is either symmetrical or is skewed to the right, you can fit a Weibull curve to it. But because a Weibull curve can fit a data, some people think they can apply the Weibull model. The difference between the curve and the model is that the model includes the theory that connects the meaning of the data to the curve. If the assumptions are invalid, the model doesn't apply. So we have this great model, but we can't apply it because the model's assumptions, the theory that connect the data to the curve, are all wrong for software testing. This is typical of surrogate measures. We don't have a theoretical justification for using a type of data, but we have a convenient set of data. And we have a kind of a plausibility argument. Maybe its assumptions don't really work if you look very closely. Maybe it's a very fuzzy argument. But we can use it as an excuse for relying on this easy-to-collect data instead of doing the hard work necessary to come up with something better. I've seen the Weibull and models like it applied in practice. I've seen serious problems. Doug Hoffman has more experience than I do with clients who are more traditionally process-oriented, and so he's seen models like this even more than I have. He wrote up his observations in The Dark Side of Software Metrics. The problem is that this model is not just descriptive. People try to change the project schedule by changing the shape of the bug curve. Executives pay attention to the model, and they put pressure on people who generate the bug curve. They want lots of bugs found early in testing because they believe that an early peak in the bug find rate predicts an early completion date. They expect one peak and a steady decline in the bug rate after that because that's what the model tells them to expect. Doug and I have seen testers cope with this pressure to maximize startup project bug counts. You can certainly do it. The testers look for cheap and easy bugs. Even if the bugs aren't very helpful to the project team, they make the numbers look good. And that keeps the executives and the measurement bureaucrats from head office happy. Unfortunately, when testers spend their early time finding bugs, they aren't spending that time building tools, or adapting tools, or preparing for test automation, or writing test plans, or training new people on the project, or doing anything else to be more efficient, more effective, or more accountable later in the project. Later in testing, the expectation is that testers will find fewer bugs each week. And managers often manage projects in terms of milestones. For a project to meet a milestone, the development team might have to show that the project satisfies certain criteria. For example, the milestone might require that a certain percentage of the features are implemented, that there is draft user documentation for X percent of those, and that the total number of not yet fixed serious bugs is less than N. On many projects, hitting a milestone is a big deal. It might trigger a bonus payment, it might trigger a contract payment, or a party, promotions, or an announcement at a company meeting. When a company adopts a mathematical model to predict milestones from bug find rates, you can imagine the pressure on testers to keep the total count of open bugs below N. All the testers have to do to meet that pressure is to find only what they're expected to find.